And our next speaker is Tomas and me. Tomas will start the presentation.
So, hello, my name is Tomas Nordlander. I'm the research manager for SINTEF optimization, and I got the honor given to me to present part of the end presentation, which described the project that is funding this webinar. And then the project manager Amela will present the remaining part of it. So the project NextGenDST, or Next Generation Decision Support Tools, is a strategic project for SINTEF, and it's funded by SINTEF, and it's research money to get more research money to investigate the intersection between optimization and human-computer interaction. And that intersection was something that became clear for us, and Ted mentioned it earlier, in the CSA project, the CEFMAP, where the optimization group here in SINTEF that have worked for 20 years with optimization and the group with human-computer interaction that have long experience with that worked first time together. And we saw that this intersection not only was interested and helped each different research domain, but we also saw that it was fairly empty when it comes to research. And the project is a two-year project, and it has 3 million Norwegian crowns in funding. And what we're going to focus on in this project is looking at these mission control centers for what we call time-critical complex domains, or like Jonas called, high-stakes domains, like the air traffic controllers, emergency management, where you currently, as Ted mentioned, you plan and schedule manually, and where a bad decision in best case leads to a high cost, and in worst case leads to life at stakes. And we want to see if we can introduce quantitative decision support, which in a way is optimization, into these environments to help to make more qualitative solution, more efficient, more safe, etc. But at the same time, and maybe seems contradictive, try to at least maintain the knowledge of the operator, and best case actually improving it. And this is a tough thing. But before I talk a little bit more about that, I will give you the shortest course of optimization for the human-computer interaction people here. It's very, very simplified. It's more complex than this, but it gives you the idea of it. So let's say in the beginning of next week, you're going to do three tasks. You want to go to the cinema, you want to visit your parents, and you need to do grocery shopping. These are the three tasks, and you have to decide when you're going to do it. So it's a planning task. You schedule it in there. This is a possible solution, right? Go to the cinema on Monday, and then parents Tuesday, and grocery shopping on Wednesday. But it's just one solution. We actually, with three different tasks, we have six different solutions. Some solutions might be better than others. That means that the movie that they are playing on Monday is actually more interesting to us than the one they're playing on Tuesday. It means that some of these actually is not a viable solution because the parents, they're not home on Wednesday. So a human is quite good in making a plan of these tasks, what we're going to do the next day. And it works really well for small problems. But the interesting part is here, if we take these three problems and we multiply it, we make twice as many tasks. How many combinations do we have then? Six? We had before, maybe we have 12, 24. No, we get 720 combinations. So by multiplying the problem, we get 120 times as many combinations to evaluate. So we're actually hitting the limit of what we manually can check and evaluate against each other. And if we continue and getting more realistic tasks that we want to plan or schedule, like in air traffic control, we get quite a number of different combinations to evaluate. Humans are quite good in finding a viable solution, but looking through 50, 100 different combinations and taking the best one, it's very low chance that you actually have a very efficient one. But these type of problems is where optimization excels. So with optimization algorithm, we can go through millions and millions of combinations and evaluate them against each other on not only 2, 4, 5 different properties, but we can evaluate it on thousands of different properties against each other and highlight the best one or some really good ones. However, optimization methods have also problems. So if we look at where we have applied optimization methods as decision support in domains where you have had manual planners and manual schedulers, so their job changed a little bit. So instead of planning and scheduling, they become, like Jonas was saying, more monitoring. And the longer time they're monitoring, their knowledge of manual, decent, efficient schedules is degrading. That means that suddenly, when the system goes down and they have to go back to manual scheduling again, they produce poor solutions. And poor solutions in these domains, at best, have a high cost to it, at worst, lighter stakes. Also, optimization in a way have worked. We talked about, I think it was Ted that talked about the black box. When we do optimization decision support, we don't give the rationale why this is a solution. We just present, this is the solution. Take it or leave it. Okay, you don't like that one. What about this one? What about this one? So when we introduce it, it basically, the operator works as a monitorer, but also as a quality assurer, say, okay, it looks feasible, nothing, okay, let's run with this one. But what we want to do in this project is we want to combine automation and human together, and we try to let the optimization part improve the quality of the decisions when it comes to safety and efficiency, but at the same time try to give the rationale why these solutions are and involve the planner in the loop to try to maintain, at least maintain the knowledge that they have, and maybe even improve it by giving the rationale. For example, on this, giving a way of playing with the system to see how some local decision can make global impact. And we hope that this could increase the trust when it comes to the optimization. That means that you basically know, okay, if the system goes down, I should still have enough competence that I can solve this quite efficiently until the system is up again. And with that, I would leave it over to Amela.
Thank you, Tomas. So Tomas said what we want to achieve, and this is very nice. The question is how we can achieve it. What is the big new idea of this project? And I think this picture actually it presents the essence of the project. And after a lot of discussion and juggling on the whiteboards, blackboards, and everything we could have, Patrick made this picture, and this is the official picture presenting the project. So what we want to do? What is our main hypothesis? We believe, of course, these automation guys, Tomas and his colleagues, they know how to find the optimal solution. You have the problem, they have the algorithms. So they would, you just give them the data, they would produce the optimal way of doing stuff, something, of scheduling something, doing something, whatever. So, and this is, we could replace it in a way by full automation in some cases, if it makes sense. Humans do their things in their human ways. They could make it optimal or less optimal, depends on the situation, depends on the domains. We believe that there is a set of solutions which might not be optimal, but very close to optimal regarding the performance, which would be different in different domains, like you have been talking, okay, about what's the optimal, what we can improve in ATM, in different domains it would be different. So there is a set of solutions which are close to the optimal one, but which the humans still could understand why should I do this? Because if you tell the operator, air traffic controller, you should do this, and they don't understand at all. They have no possibility to understand, because Tomas and Patrick and Carlo are finding the best solution by simply going through all possible solutions. And it, not always this is simplified, sorry, yes. view of an optimization. So there is a solution, or a set of solutions we could explain to humans, the rationale behind that, that humans could execute also. And we also believe that there is a way that we interact, you know, have mentioned these different levels of automation, that these levels of automation should be in a way dynamic, flexible, that it should be adapted to my needs as an operator, to the needs of the tasks, of the situation, and that I should be able to interact with this automation in such way that this automatic tool or agent, if, as you said, understand what are my preferences, in a way that I interact with this tool would not only keep me in the loop and help me to keep my competence, but also help me to improve my competence, to learn. If the tool said, but you should do this, you should schedule these planes like this, sequence these planes like this on the taxiway, and I say, this is because of this and this, and the impact of global impact on this solution would be reducing CO2 print or something else. And I learn, and next time I do it by myself. Or we could do that in a random way. We assign this task to automatic tools or agents or the humans, so that we have the humans in the loop all the time, but they keep or develop further their competence. So this is what is covered by this jumping level of automation possible by rethinking human machine or human computer interface. So I believe that we really have to think of this collaboration or symbiosis in a completely new way, and to design this as a one holistic new system. And we promise to our people funding this project that we would increase, we expect 20 to 50% of performance improvement. As Ted mentioned, we actually had studies showing this, so we think this is possible. So this is the big idea. We also want the way how to do it. I mean, that sounds nice and looks nice in the slide, but how to do it in real life. We believe the solution is that to develop this in a human-centered way. We want to do something nobody ever done in history, as far as we know, is to apply the methods and the principles of human-computer interaction, of user-centered design, on developing algorithms. So these principles we know from developing all these apps and things around us, computers. We want to see how it works here. Could we really make the algorithm so that they not only produce the best solution, but produce something which is acceptable or useful for humans? So which questions, so which questions we need to investigate, which questions we need to answer in this research project that, you know, we just started. So this is in front of us. One question is how to capture efficiently humans' intentions, preferences, what they are able to implement, because what I can do depends on the situation. It's not the same if 10 planes are contacting me while I'm controlling air traffic, and the automatic solution propose something which I simply physically can't do. Or in some others, under some other circumstances, this could be a good solution. So how to capture what humans can do, so the interaction part of it. How to find the decisions on this diagram which are close to the optimal ones, but humans can control, understand, execute. The third one is the output side of input output. how to recommend decisions and explain the rationale behind them and explain the global impact in a pedagogical way. You know, we don't want to tell him to do this and this. We want the way to give our message in a way that will enable them to keep their competence, to execute this, to learn something from this. And this is all of these are actually non-explored marks in a way. So we see in front of us a lot of interesting studies and research papers of the researchers. The next one, please. So what's next? Next step. The project just started after the new year. This workshop was the first one when we wanted simply to gather people interested in this topic so that you could help us. As you've seen, the problem is pretty difficult, so we need all the help we can. We will first start by developing and prototyping the tool based on this idea. And we want, as I said, this would be user-centered design and development. We want to include the users and, of course, all stakeholders in our design and user studies. We are going to organize user workshops, relation studies, where you can participate by being there or online. We have some fantastic tools for involving users, in, online involving users in design and prototyping and evaluation developed here at SINTEF. My colleague Asbjorn sitting here. So you could participate in the design user studies. If you have similar projects or something which is close to this, we would like to collaborate with you. We already seen the team has had some projects which are close to some projects we have. Also, as Tomas said, the purpose of this project is not only to produce research results, but also to produce new projects, more money to SINTEF and all of you. So we want to collaborate with you on new National Research Council funded projects for Horizon 2020 projects. Maybe the next one. If you are interested in this, please contact us. Here are our mails. We will make available this talk and slides and questions. Everything will be put on our project site after this, after the end of the seminar. So we hope that next time on this map, the red are the countries, or the countries colored by red, are the countries where we have participants from. So we hope the next time that the whole Europe will be red, or maybe the whole globe, we don't know, but we will do our best.
The whole universe.
Yeah, the whole, yeah, good, good. So that would be